My Father, send me help from your sanctuary and strengthen me out of Zion. I pray for the help that comes from your sanctuary. Give me the help that comes from your sanctuary. Jehovah God, that your mighty hands and your mighty power to you alone be glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. In 2 Chronicles chapter 26 in verse 7, the word of the Lord was talking about King Amaziah, that God helped him against the Philistine and against the Arabian that dwell in Mount Beer. In verse 8, the Bible says, his enemy began to bring him gifts. Now, when God helps a man, he will be victorious. In the battles of life, we all need help. And until God help you against the battle of life, the enemy will prevail over you. You want to talk to the Almighty God once again this morning, say to him, Father, in every battle of life, in every opposition in life, grant me your help and let me prevail in the name of Jesus. Talk it over with the Lord. My Lord and my God, I ask for your help. Oh God, I pray. Lord, send me help against all my adversities, against every battles of life. Loving and glorious Father, my Lord, I pray for help. Help me in every area of my life. In the mighty name of Jesus, grant me, O God, your help. For vain is the help of man. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank you, blessed Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, as you read in verse 4, in the day of King Jehoshaphat, the Bible says, and Judah gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord. Even out of all the city of Judah, they came to seek the Lord for help. And by the time you get to verse 23 of the chapter, you discover that God set their enemy against each other. Now, there were overwhelming enemy coming against Jehoshaphat and the people. And so they look up unto the Lord and say, God, be our help. And God granted them help. He turned their enemy against each other. And without lifting up their hand, they maintained a victory. Say to the Lord again, say to him, Father, in every opposition in life, give me victory without battle. Help me in every area of my life. Give me victory without a battle. Give me victory without a fight. In the mighty name of Jesus. My Lord, I pray that by your mighty power, Lord, grant me your help. Loving and glorious Father, grant me your help. Jehovah, the mighty King, help me against every opposition in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, blessed Father. Blessed be the name of the Lord. To you be glory and to you be honor. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. I have no power of my own, of my own. I have no power. power of my own. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, I look unto you. Help me, I have no power of my power of my own. I have no power of my power of my own. Father, we rest on your ability this morning. We rest on your grace and we rest on your power. And we make a declaration for you that we have no power of our own. We have no strength of our own. But we depend on your power. We depend on your ability. We depend on your grace. Lord, send us help from your sanctuary. And strengthen us out of Zion. In the mighty name of Jesus. You help the people that has gone ahead of us. Father, please help us. In every area possible. Father, please help us. Every battle confronting each one here. I pray the Lord will grant you victory. Total and complete in the mighty name of Jesus. Every enemy that has been contending with you. Today, the Lord weaken them and strengthen you over them in the mighty name of Jesus. This week, help that you never expect will come for you. This month, help you have never requested for will be granted unto you. This year, help you never believed possible will come your way in the name of Jesus. So shall it be. So it is. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And the people of God will say better, amen. Let me hear you praise the Lord. The Lord bless you. You can please take your seat. You are welcome to the service this morning. And as it has been announced to us, we are doing the rounding up of our help weekend today. The help weekend is anchored by the choir, the ushering, the prayer department, and the welfare department of the church. It is one weekend in a year when, as a church, we put something together to help those who are in need. And I want to believe God that we are here ready to also give something to support the weak. And as you do, the Almighty God will bless you in Jesus' name. The topic we are given is the great shepherd is a great helper. The great shepherd is the great helper. Now God, the Almighty, who is the sheep shepherd of the sheep, according to Psalm 23, verse 1 to 6, is a shepherd who lead and guide his own on the path they should go, so that they can enjoy all the privilege and the benefit that he has for them. Jesus also, in John chapter 10, as we read from verse 1 to 18, also said the same thing. He called himself the good shepherd. The good shepherd that laid down his life because of his sheep, in order to redeem the sheep, in order to defend the sheep, the good shepherd laid down his life. And for those of us who are children of God, we find a worthy example in Christ, our leader, and God, our Father. And so, it is the expectation of God that we are also a helper, a shepherd and a helper. In James chapter 1, when you read in verse 27, James chapter 1, verse 27, the word of the Lord says, but pure and undefiled before God, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Now God, you know, is giving us a picture here. What an undefiled and a perfect religion look like. He said, it is to consider the fatherless and to consider the cause of the widows in the affliction. To identify with the weak so that we can also produce strength for them. In both the Old and New Testament, we see God desiring his children to show compassion to the poor and the needy. And Jesus said to us in Matthew 26, 11, that the poor we will always have, that there will always be a poor around us to minister unto. You know, because, you know, fingers are not equal, but those who are poor will always be there, and they are supposed to be at the benevolence of the one who are strong, the one who are able, the one that God has blessed. You may not have all, you know, the full storehouses, but God is satisfying your life with good things. Now, if God is feeding you and is satisfying you, God at the same time wants you to remember your brother and your sister who may also be in need. God also expects us that we show mercy to the poor, to the sick, and to the needy, you know, by ministering unto them personally. And that was what Jesus said to us in Matthew chapter 25, as you read from verse 35 to 40. Matthew chapter 25, as you read from verse 35 to 40. You know, he expected us to visit those in prison. He expected us to clothe the naked. He expected us, you know, to give food to the hungry so that we will be a blessing unto them as God has been a blessing unto us. And if we do this, it is highly rewarding if we give ourselves into this. Now, there is no doubt about it that in our present world, now poverty and lack is evident in many places. Now, as many of us who have been watching international news, you discover the issue of migrants here and there. Now, what is the thing that is pushing them from one place to the other? It is because it is starvation, it is famine, it is hunger that is making people to migrate from one place to the other in search for a greener pasture. Now, people may not be, you know, migrating towards us, but it is an indication that God has created the comfortable and the rich to take care of the poor. And unless the rich, the comfortable, do something about the poor, now, if their crisis come, even the rich will not be able to bear. You'll discover that some of those nations that are comfortable, that are not going through war, now, the issue of migration is posing a threat unto them today, because if people who are hungry enter into a community, you can expect anything. So God wants us to do something willingly on it so that we'll be able to save life and we'll be able to prove that we belong to God. The symbol of true godliness is in taking care of the needy. The symbol of godliness is in taking care of the needy. How much you care for the needy really show to the world that you are a godly person. In Jeremiah chapter 22, when you read in verse 16, Jeremiah chapter 22, in verse 16, it was being said concerning King Josiah there that he defended the cause of the poor and needy. And so all went well. Is that not what it means to know me, saith the Lord? God was saying this and said, is it not all about showing care to your brother and be your brother's keeper that really shows that you know God? Now, it is not enough to say, I know God and I love God. But how much you are willing to give to others and help others show how much of God that you know. Moses, in his instruction to the people of Israel, gave them specific order and commandment which he received from the Lord concerning the poor and the needy. You know, in Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 10, you know, the children of Israel were told, give generously to them and do so without grudging heart. Each time there is an opportunity to give to the needy, it must be done generously and without a grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything that you put your hands to do. The key to blessing is in helping others. When you give a helping hand, you are sowing a seed. And whatever that a man sow is the same thing that he will reap. In the law, various laws that God gave to the children of Israel, one of them is this law of the harvest. God has said to them in that Deuteronomy chapter 15, in verse 11 to be precise, that the poor will not cease in the land. And so if the poor will not cease in the land, now they must be taken care of. And God gave them a mandate and a law as to how to handle it. So you find in the passage like Leviticus chapter 19, verse 9 to 10, Leviticus 19, verse 9 to 10, God was saying to the children of Israel, when you plant your field and it is time to harvest them, he said, you must not harvest the corners of your field. You must leave it to the poor. In other words, deliberately, when it comes to harvesting, you will take some of the things and you will leave some so that the poor and the needy will come to your field and come there to come and pluck, to come and take something they will eat. Some of those grain that fall from your hand, you are expected to leave it behind for them because they will come, pick them up, separate the grain from the sand, and take it home, and they go and feed on. Now, each time you do this, you are giving yourself an opportunity for somebody to be mentioning your name before God and to be praying for you. There is no how somebody will eat your food and will curse you. Each time they remember that you are the one, it is through your hand that their last meal came, they will always pray for you, because the more the Lord blesses you, the more the Lord preserves you, the more of such blessing they will get. Amen? So, Leviticus 23, verse 22, and Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 21, all were saying one thing: always remember the poor. Now, God was talking directly to the people of Israel, who are predominantly farmers. Now, when it is time to harvest your field, you must leave some for the poor. Now, if we apply it to today's content, now we'll say, God is saying, when you earn your salary, you must also remember the poor. You must deliberately get something out to say, This one for welfare. This one for those that are less privileged. This one for those that are still trusting God and believing God for something to happen, for God to make a way for them. And by so doing, you open the door of blessing. And that is what that Deuteronomy 15 verse 10 said to us, that in so doing, he said, the Lord your God will bless the works of your hand. Everything you lay your hands upon to do will be blessed. So each time you want to sow seed, principally, you sow seed to God and you sow seed to the needy. The guarantee, you know, the continuity of God's blessing in your life. And this is the scripture, and the scripture cannot be broken. Amen. Your blessing is connected to how much, how generous you are. Proverbs chapter 19 verse 17 make it very clear. Proverbs 19 17 says, he who give to the poor is lending to God. Whoever supports the needy is giving a loan to God. When you give loan to people, or when people collect loan, there is always an interest. And so if you give your loan to God, definitely there will always be interest. I don't think there is any bank that can give you the kind of interest that God will give over your investment. So taking care of the needy is a worthy investment. And each time that you do, you are speaking longevity to yourself. You are speaking prosperity into yourself. You are speaking abundance into yourself. Amen. Proverbs chapter 22 verse 9 also said, Proverbs 22 verse 9, blessed you will become when you care for the poor. You become blessed as you take care of the poor. And why is this so? Why is this blessing so? Proverbs chapter 14 verse 31 give us a clue why there is always a blessing in taking care of the needy. It says, whoever is kind to the needy, honor God. Whoever, whosoever is kind to the needy, he says, such a one honoreth God. And so there is no way you will honor God and God will not bless you. One thing that God asked from the children of Israel again and again is his honor. For example, in Malachi chapter 1 verse 6, he asked them, every servant, you know, fear their master, and every son honor their, you know, their father, the master fear their master, the servant fear their master, and the son, you know, honor their father. He said, if I'm your father, where is my honor? And one way by which we honor God is what Proverbs 14:31 has said to us. It is in taking care of the needy. If you read that Malachi 1:6 very well, you will see it was as if God was angry in talking to his children. Why? Because they have neglected what they were supposed to be doing. And so, in taking care of the needy, we are doing exactly what God wanted us to do, and the blessing of God, you know, always flow in our direction. And many passages in the scripture, you know, guarantee blessing into our life each time we show, you know, our generosity to the needy, and danger if we refuse to do so. Proverbs chapter 19 verse 17 is one of them. Proverbs 19, 17 and Proverbs chapter 29 verse 7. Now the consequences for ignoring the plight of the poor are also made clear. You know, Proverbs chapter 21 verse 13 say, if a man shut his ears to the cry of the poor, he said, he too will cry and God will not hear. That the one who shut his ears or ear to the cry of the poor, is that that person also has blocked the door into answer prayer. Now that tells us something. One of the secrets to answered prayer is taking care of the needy. So, because once somebody cries for help and you help them, when you sow the seed of help, you get the harvest of help. Amen? Some of the time, there are certain things that may be very hard to believe in the scripture. Now, each one of us work for our money. We work for whatever things we earn. But God wants to determine some of the way by which those earning must go. And it is in allowing God to be God. It is in walking according to the instruction and the dictates of the law that we get all the blessing that must follow our life. Amen? Proverbs chapter 28, verse 27. Proverbs 28, verse 27. The Bible says, curse will follow those who did not care for the needy. Some passages in the scripture are not very palatable. You know, because you look at them. You know, you are supposed to be the master over everything you have. But most of the time, if we understand the principle and how God operates, it will be very easy for us to walk in the instruction and in the way of the Lord. So God is giving us on a strong note and with a strong language that unless we take care of the poor, unless we do something about their matters, he said we may incur his wrath and his anger. If you look at that passage in Matthew 25 very well, from verse 35 to 40, you discover that God was saying, He said, he will say to the sheep that will be on the right, come into the kingdom of your father that has been prepared for you from the foundation of the earth. He said, for I was hungry and you fed me. I was naked, you clothed me. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was in prison, you visited me. And then they were asking, when do we see you naked and clothed you? When do we see you, you know, hungry and fed you? Or when do we visit you in prison? And he said, and he will reply them, inasmuch as you have done it to one of the least of one of you, you have done it unto me. Each time you care for the needy, you are ministering unto God directly. And when you minister unto God, God also gets back unto you to get the best into your life. When you read about the atrocity of Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis chapter 19, we were not told all the things they did until we got to Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 49. Ezekiel 16, verse 49. Now, the scripture said to us here, one of the crime that the people of Sodom and Gomorrah committed was that they never helped the poor and the needy. They closed their ears. They held back their hands to the cry of the needy. And God decided to, you know, even if I want to overlook any other error, I will not overlook this and wipe them out. Now, a lot of things places a demand on us as children of God. And we really want to walk in the footprint of blessing, we must look at this word that God has given unto us and operate in this principle. Sometimes when you want to bless people, it is not because you like them, or it is not because they are good to you. You do good to people not because they are good, but because it is good to be good. A good man is doing it unto himself, So when you do good to them, you are not doing them anything. You are doing it to yourself. Something is being credited into your account. Into your account. And so when it is done into your account, definitely you get something that will bring a reward back into your life. That's why in the New Testament, 1 John chapter 3, as you read from verse 17 to 18, 1 John chapter 3, verse 17 to 18, the word of the Lord make it clear to us that if any one of us has the possession of this world and seeth his brother in need and close his bowel of compassion against him, he said, how can you say you have the Spirit of God in you? What really show that you have Spirit of God in you is by being compassionate unto those who are less privileged. And so he concluded by saying, beloved, we should not love ordinarily in the mouth, in the word of the mouth, but we must love indeed. So when you see a needy, it is not only prayer you pray for them, you also minister unto their need, because that is the thing that will bring satisfaction into their life. And in ministering to the needy, it is not until when you have leftovers, because some of the misgiving in the heart of many people is that, well, I don't have leftover yet. Now, if you want to wait until you have leftover, you may never help anybody. But sometimes, even in the midst of your need, even in the midst of your want, you need to minister even unto others. And it is by so doing that you get the best that the Almighty God has to offer. Amen? And when that happens, it brings you into all the blessing and all the things that God wants to bring into your life. When you read the passage like 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and read from verse 1, we could learn some beautiful lesson from the church in Macedonia. It said, moreover, brethren, we do you to weep of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. How that in a great trial of affliction and abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. Verse 3 says, for to their power I bear record, yea, and beyond their power, they were willing of themselves. Willing of themselves, praying us with much entreaty that we will receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And this they did, not as we hope, but first gave their own self to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. What was the testimony about the churches in Macedonia? It was that even though they were not rich, but they have the grace and the willing heart to give out. They don't have something to, left over, but yet they consider the poor. Even in they look at other churches and say, well, our other brethren that is in other places, we are better off. We can send this little. So out of the little they have, they contributed something and say, let's send this one to them, so that they can be ministered unto them. Amen. And that brings them into the place of abundance of blessing. They enjoy this blessing again and again and again. Another worthy example is this woman, the widow of Sarephath, that we read about in 1 Kings chapter 17. You read that story from verse 8. Now, at the time Elijah was coming into a place, her testimony was that she has a meal for two, their last meal that is only enough and sufficient for two people. And the man of God said, well, I am also in need, and so let's divide the food into three and bring my own first. Teaching us a very serious principle there, that each time you have, you know, there are people to be, needs to be met. One of the things we need to do is not wait until you have, you know, left over that you say, okay, you can come and take this. You put them in your plan and in your agenda. You see someone that is in need. Now include them as you are preparing your meal. Now that same meal that you alone will have eaten, you cut a little bit out of it and blesses somebody out of it, so that their own life also can be satisfied, so that they can have something to hang on their life. Now, God directed Elijah, into the house of this widow. And when he got to the house of the widow was saying, all I have was the meal for two, and I don't have any other thing. All after that meal, it is dead. But by the reason of her giving, she enjoyed the rest of her life in abundance. May that be your experience. May that be your opportunity in the mighty name of Jesus. And we need to understand that when there is a need to be met and we refuse to meet them, God always finds a way of meeting his need. When God wanted to feed Elijah and nobody was willing around, you know, God prepared the ravens, the birds. He asked the prophet to stay by the brook Cherith, and he commanded the ravens to bring him food morning and evening, morning and evening, to, you know, to satisfy him in that place. Now, if a man will not do what they should do, Jesus said, if man will not praise God, he said, God is able to raise stone. The question we need to ask ourselves this morning, do I want to fulfill God's purpose, or am I expecting God to raise stone in my position? Because any position you do not occupy, God will look for somebody else or something else to take it. Because life does not give room to vacuum. If you are not doing it, it just has to be done. And until you have done what you should do, you may not be able to get everything that needed to be gotten. Each time we talk about Philippians 4:19, we always quote it, my God, it is written, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. It is always good to read those scriptures very well. No, we can personalize them, but we must get them from the original concept and get the background very well. Now, to qualify for that passage, you need to move a little bit. Look at what qualified, you know, this, the Philippians church for, you know, this thing, so that you can get all the blessing. I may want to read that chapter of the Bible before we close this morning. Philippians chapter 4, maybe I take it from verse 10. It said, but I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me has flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lack opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content, and I know both how to be abased and how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. Then in verse 14 he said, notwithstanding, ye have done well that ye have did communicate with my affliction. Now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. For even in Thessalonica, ye sent once and again to my necessity, not because I desire a gift, But I desire fruit that may abound to your account. But I have all and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well-pleasing unto God. Then we come to verse 19 and say, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. So verse 19 is a subsequent result of what has happened from verse 14. Now they have done, they have ministered unto Paul in prison. When he was under affliction, they visited as required by the Bible, that we just asked us, you know, lend a helping hand. And so the God of the one you bless is the one who blesses you in return. The God of the one you ministered unto, the God of the one whom you have honored, is the one who brings honor into your life. And that is the reason why I want to challenge you today, that beginning from this moment, we will program ourselves in such a way that our ears will be open to the cry of the needy, and on a regular basis, we will not even wait for somebody to ask for us, but we will also be setting something apart to take care of the needy ones amongst us. And as we do, the Almighty God will bless us abundantly in Jesus' name. And I want to believe God with us that everything that we lay our hands upon will prosper. It will flourish. It will blossom in the name of Jesus. And as we sow the seed of caring, we will have the harvest of caring in the name of Jesus. As we minister to the needs of others, you will never know lack. You will never be in want. You will never be in need in the name of Jesus. The Lord will speed up his hand to meet every need even before they arise in the name of Jesus. He will provide for everything that is yours and bless you all around in the name of Jesus. So it shall be in the mighty name of Jesus.